Okay. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to this webinar this morning. On behalf of all the organizing chambers, the Norwegian British Chamber, the Finnish British Chamber, and the Danish UK Association, we would like to welcome you to this webinar, kindly supported and hosted by Quiver Management this morning. Briefly again, using technology, we will be using Zoom here today, and you'll see two buttons at the bottom of your screen, one with a chat function and one with a Q&A function. The Q&A is really for you. Whenever you have questions, fire it off right away, and I will moderate it as we go through the presentation this morning. The chat function is, Jan will be using that occasionally, and I may actually start out here with, just to get a feel for where you all are. Are you sitting at home? Where are you? Please consider using that. And I've just fired off on chat a few questions here. Please pop your name in. Where are you currently sitting? Are you working from home? Are you working maybe from the office still? Please spend a minute to reply back on that. Good morning, Lucien. I may also want to say here that in the chat function, you have the option of choosing all attendees, all panelists. If you take that option, then you can see what everyone else are entering.
Yeah, I can see quite a few just sending to the panelists. Send to panelists and everyone. You have that choice down in the chat box and everybody can see where we're getting from. I can see most people at home. We were sort of expecting that. Right.
It's nice to see that we're getting quite far around. We're in Rotterdam, we're in Switzerland, Gloucestershire, Edinburgh, Bath. Lovely.
Excellent, yeah. Oh, we'll keep going. That's excellent. Trondheim, so, oh yeah, we are spreading around the world. Helsinki, that's excellent. A few from London and Hampshire. Excellent. I can see more joining fast and furiously now up there as well. So excellent. This should be a good group today here.
And there was one who was still watching.
One of the advantages of webinars, isn't that we can get people from around the world collating here.
Yeah. Let me move on and with this kick off the webinar and starting with introducing our host. Now, the coronavirus pandemic has made remote and home working a sudden enforced reality upon us all on a scale, on a global scale that we haven't really experienced before in our lifetime. And it's most likely going to have some lasting impressions to the way we work and how we live going forward. Leading and motivating a remote team require a new approach and skill set for many managers and leaders, and also for the staff getting used to working from home and away from your fellow team members and colleagues. Our speaker today is an award-winning executive coach, trainer, and company chair. He has led remote teams for over two decades as a senior executive, as CEO in a large Danish corporates, and as managing director of two European consultancies. He has coached and worked with hundreds of senior executive teams, many of them geographically dispersed all over. When he is not running ultra marathons across the deserts of Africa, he is running a remote team of 15 coaches and trainers and chairing two company boards, both also dealing with the challenges and managing staff working from home. Jan is, I'm pleased to say, a fellow and longstanding member with his company, Quiver Management, at the Danish UK Association. So sharing tips for how to lead and motivate your newly remote teams, I would like to give the word over to you, Jan. Please take it from here.
Excellent. Thank you, Gunnar. Let me just share the screen again and then kick off here. So thank you, Gunnar, and also, of course, to the Danish, the Norwegian and Finnish Chambers of Commerce in UK that is co-hosting this. It's great to have everybody here. So remote working and virtual teams are actually quite a long-term trend. But what is happening now, of course, with the COVID-19 pandemic and all the restrictions that's brought about, is it sort of supercharged that. suddenly we are sort of all leaving the office buildings, business parks, premises empty and deserted across large parts of the world. The good news, though, since it has been going on for quite a while, is we know actually quite a bit about the challenges of working from home and the challenges of leading virtual teams. But what probably makes it sort of even more pertinent and topical at the minute is this enforced and very sudden nature of so many people who previously co-located are suddenly working from home. But the real leadership challenge is not, of course, just in terms of how you lead, but it's also your own sort of work environment as you as leaders are working from home. So I'm going to look sort of a bit of both. And in my talk today, I'm going to recognize, of course, the context of COVID-19. But I think it's worth remembering that afterwards as well, many of you will probably over the in the future start to get more used to and having to work more with remote teams and virtual teams in the longer term. So let me sort of just go through what I'm going to talk about today. Basically four areas. First, talk a bit about home working, both for yourself and for your teams, and that suddenly shift, particularly if there are newbies in that space. Then we'll talk a bit about motivating team members when they're remote. And leading that on from that really is about leading remote teams. What can you do to lead them more effectively? And one particular area I will cover almost underneath that is the productivity element. How do you get the best out of your team? How do you ensure they're productive when they're now working in that remote environment rather than co-located with you? And as Gunnar has alluded to, we will use the chat function and Q&A function. We actually want to make this really quite interactive. And the first thing we'll start with is with a quick poll, just to get a sense of how many of your team members are actually now working from home. So I will launch the poll. And that should now be on your screen. So if you would answer these three quick questions, please, we will see what the statistics tell us. We will give that typically about 20, 30 seconds, and you should all have answered these. I can see the numbers coming up and how many is answering. That's excellent. We'll leave a few more, another 10 seconds, and see how many manage to answer. Oh, there's quite a split here. Oh, still many answers coming in. I'll give you a little more time. I guess some of you might just have to find the keyboard first in wherever you are. Excellent. So I will try and share the results to see if the technology allows us. Yes, it did indeed. So what we're seeing here is that quite a few have relatively small teams of 1 to 9. And that's all 2/3 here by the looks of it. And about one in five is about 10 to 49. And then a few up to 250. What I also see on the next answer is that in terms of working from home, there's a few who did that. That's really not quite a split here from none up to all already. And then how many of your team are now working from home? That has suddenly jumped from quite a spread to 50% and actually 90% of all of you are in a situation now where all of the team or majority of your team is working from home. A really sort of shift. And you can scroll down, by the way, if you want to follow how the results are so you can see the results. Yeah, I can see others are saying that as well. Good. So what does that tell us? Well, actually, I will just stop sharing the results there. And what you will see is that let me just make that sure that moves on. This is sort of what we have seen happen so urgently here, that you can see that over the last 5 years, we've had this trend that home working is increasing, but to be honest, it's quite a small number. It was 4 to 5% that we saw the increase over those 4 years, just about from 4 in 2015 to about 5% by the December 2019, so just about 3 or 4 months ago. And what's happening now? Well, actually, we don't have a real clear numbers, but we're probably talking about 2/3 of the population, if not more, working population are now working from home. So that's going to be a brand new experience for many people. And actually, there was less than 30% of the workforce has ever worked from home in their current job. That is statistics for the UK. So what that's telling us is, in many respects, that the majority of people, this is brand new. So it used to be probably more common in the IT industry. We know that from statistics, but more customer-facing industries, much less, probably less than 10% there, whereas the industry, IT industry, we saw sort of more like 50% were used to doing it, not necessarily all the time, but regularly at least. And we also know that about a third of employers predict that their staff will predominantly work remotely by the end of the next decade. So there is really an expectation this is going to be much more prevalent, but what the coronavirus has done is really supercharged this. So what's my prediction on this? Well, of course, once we get out of this, my prediction is that we will see a lot of people going back to the co-located environment, maybe not all. And then I think we'll start to see an acceleration in home working. I predict that it probably will be the acceleration is mostly in the flexible home working, so people working some days at home, but not necessarily all the time. So this is a reality I think we as leaders need to face into. This is the way the world is going to be, quite a regular thing for people to work from home. So I think that makes the subject even more pertinent. What is, however, an added issue challenge today is that the majority of children are now at home because schools and nurseries have closed for a period across many countries in Europe and further. And therefore, your staff members will need to manage actually full-time childcaring responsibility alongside their paid work if they are still working. And we know that a quarter of households in the UK certainly have dependent children under 16, where both of the parents are working, or as we say, let's say all parents are working, because about a fifth of those households, it'll be single parent families. So that's a lot of pressure on the individual staff member to balance and manage both. So another question for you. And this is focused more on this question spoken more on your own aspects. So what have you found yourself sort of the most challenging aspects of working from home? If you could answer that question in the chat function, that would be great. And remember, you have that little option at the bottom that says two panelists. You can also say two panelists and all attendees. Please click that before you send the message so everybody can see your answers. So please give me your responses to what have you found the most challenging part of working from home yourself? Finding a natural work rhythm, sitting online meetings all day long. Oh yeah, do I recognize that? Managing remotely regular breaks. Technical issues, distractions, lack of people contact. Oh, this is coming fast and furious. you're actually working more, yes. Yeah, you set up your home so it's a home, not a workplace. Absolutely recognize that. Time for the kids. Yeah, this is really new to so many people. So the whole routine and experience is just changing. Work ergonomics, yes. Not sitting as comfortably and as professionally as hopefully in the workplace. Manage daycare. having to inspire and motivate employees. Yeah, there's some things there that we'll definitely cover. Excellent. Keep in touch with colleagues, both business, socially, absolutely. And there is no doubt that you're sort of reflecting what we're seeing many business owners are struggling with when we're coaching them, and also when what they do as individuals. So there is the routine and experience of working from home. It feels very new and chaotic. There's a lot of changes on the work and private front. And of course, we have to add to that almost the mental health pressure that's on us, that we are worried about our health. We are worried about maybe family. We have the children around. More long-term, we would expect sort of that isolation to become an issue for many people. So there's those on top. Then we have the productivity as an umbrella of issues that I see many facing due to distraction, technology maybe not being quite right, that the company hasn't set up so you can easily access information, the processes are not working, access to information, Wi-Fi speed. Yes, that has definitely dropped now that so many are working from home. Then there's the social part, another top one we see along that list, and I see generally that interacting with colleagues, we're now missing the banter around the water cooler and the coffee machine, those conversation. And then there is another regular thing is that because we're not used to that work pattern, then unplugging after work, when do we start work, when do we stop, is not necessarily clear. And we also know from the more seasoned remote workers, virtual workers, that they have that sense of feeling outside of the loop. I haven't seen that coming up. It might have appeared, but that's that sense of isolation from the rest of the team if many of the other team members are actually co-located, but you are not, that you feel that you somehow sort of a lower rank in terms of information sharing and the influence in the organization. So there's a lot of challenges involved, no doubt about it. But let's also recognize there's definitely some benefits as well. And I'm going to share 8. I'm sure you might be coming up to more. The flexible schedule is the greatest benefit cited by home workers, and because it allows for a better work-life balance. And I will probably put that in as a little abadabai on that one. And that is that I think that was when people chose to work from home, or they applied for a job, or they had an arrangement with their workplace that they will now start to do this, because that's by choice. I think for many people now, it wasn't by choice, it was forced upon them. So it doesn't feel as big as a benefit at this point. Stress level, when people work from home, they report consistently that they have their health is better, they're less stressed, they have a better diet, more exercise. And of course, you save for many people enormous amount of time commuting backwards and forwards, and also the cost of commuting backwards and forwards. And then there's something that's probably shared by a lot, that is the higher productivity. And I see a couple of people saying the opposite. And I think it's because it wasn't arranged correctly. You were not really quite prepared for it. And there's a comment there, might be more stressful to work from home. Yes, and that's actually probably one of the things that, because the most people that's been surveyed in these, they was by choice that chose to work from home. If you now have to face into working from home and at the same time maybe have family around, it's not the work environment you designed to be in. The stress might actually be higher. But productivity, just to come back to that one, 2/3 of employees who work from home will say that they're more effective because there's less distractions. And actually a number of companies have done research around this, and the productivity improvement can be quite dramatic when everything is set up right. So for example, American Express, we know they're 43% more productive, the remote workers compared to the in-house workers, when everything was set up correctly for both. Then in terms of the company, we know that there's lower staff turnover for companies where they allow their staff member to work from home, that typically around a 20% lower staff turnover. So that, of course, is quite an economic benefit. In terms of attracting new staff, we know from research, again, that it's a strong incentive when people choose their jobs, and when they're in the job, if the employer offers flexible working, that they can work from home. And of course, if you start to take that to the ultimate where everybody is working, or some people are working from home full time, well, that allows you to recruit from a much wider pool of talent, well beyond the geographic location where you have your offices. And of course, there's savings of office space if you can have more people working from home. And then, of course, we sort of save the world to some extent. That's probably exaggerated, but there is definitely a big impact on the commuting, so less greenhouse gases from less traveling. And then one thing I just want to mention, because I wouldn't quite call it a benefit necessarily, but it's more that one of the concerns we see a lot of companies voice is that there'll be less engagement for people who work from home. Actually, quite consistently, research tells us and experience tells us for people who are remote workers, they are just as engaged, just as committed to the organization as the people within the organization. No worse, no better. So that is not really something we should be concerned about if it's all set up. But I recognize in the current COVID-19 pandemic restrictions that actually many of these things that is generally seen as benefits of home working may not all actually be realized by individuals, certainly not in the short term where it feels potentially more stressful, not quite that big a benefit. And I want to sort of just mention an experiment that was done by a particular organization called C-Trip. You may not have heard about it, but it's China's largest travel agent. And they had 500 people in the organization who had voiced and said that they would actually like to work from home full time. And what they decided to do with this group of 500 was that 50% got the opportunity, while the other half continued to work from the office. And what did they see from that experiment? That was over a 9-month experiment. The performance from the home workers went up 13% compared to the people in the office, and staff turnover dropped by 50% compared to the people who worked in the office. But what makes this really interesting is that at the end of it, they offered the home working opportunity to all 500, both the ones that has worked from home for 9 months and the one who they continue to work in the office. And half of the people who worked at home remotely for 9 months wanted to return to the office, mainly due to loneliness. And 3/4 of the control group continued to work, wanted to work from office. So only 1/4 of those that had worked in the office for 9 months while their colleagues had worked at home wanted to now start to work from home. So it's not a straightforward thing here. I think we also have to recognize that this is a bit different as a personality. There is, what are people actually gaining from coming to work? Some people come to work because, or many come from money, I appreciate that, but it's important to them to have that social interaction with workmates being around them. And others have a more propensity to saying, actually, I enjoy working from home. So it is not a straightforward picture in terms of what people prefer. But what I think generally we can accept is that home working is going to be a lot more prevalent in the future. And as leaders, we need to be good at managing that. Unfortunate situation now, in one respect, is that it's forced upon us. Maybe in long term, it will actually start to open up the eyes for both employers and employees that there's real possibilities in this. The barriers of are not as big as we think in terms of how effective we can be. So let me share 10 home working tips for newbies. And I hope that will help any here who both work from home and haven't done it before, and as you're managing team members. And some of those are, the first really here, 5 as you see them there, fundamentally is about getting yourself into some good routines, morning and evening. We know that helps a lot for home working. So it's actually simple things. Get up at the same time in the morning on a regular time anyway. Have a routine of breakfast, getting dressed, showered. And I mean getting dressed as if you are going to work. Having that routine, and also when you're doing virtual meetings, that you're actually dressed in the professional level that you would normally do at work. Maybe not this full suit, but certainly not in the pajamas when you're having meetings with colleagues and clients. And then it's also about setting up the workspace to be efficient. And of course, not everybody's got the home to do that, but for people who want to get the most out of it, have a dedicated office space, get the technology set up, which of course is both on the employers and the employees yourself to get that organized so it actually works. And then the next ones is really about the social side, which we know is critically important, particularly because of the shock at the minute to people. A lot of home workers have end up sometimes isolating themselves from others. And part of it, yeah, we have to isolate in terms of physical contact, but we can actually still socially interact. So when you get the opportunity, when you have conversation, don't just be task oriented. When you as a leader have conversation with your team in team meetings, in your phone calls, one-to-ones, to have a little banter or talk about your home life, have joint coffee breaks with colleagues, communicate regularly. And when you do have virtual team meetings, make sure that you are focused and present. So one of the things that we see too often is that in virtual meetings, whether it's a video or phone call, people get distracted by emails. They actually sit and multitask. Good piece of advice is, as for yourself as leaders, and encourage your team members, when they're in a meeting, when they're on a video call, focus on that. And I hope today that all of you are not sitting there doing something else at the same time. Enjoy that you can now have interaction with others. And then a couple of final tips. Keep developing yourself and keep developing your team members, encouraged to do that. One of the things we see too often is that home workers tend to almost stay in a little bit of a bubble and not focus enough on how can I develop my skills, how can I get better at my job, how do I follow trends in my industry. So don't stand still. And then finally, actually enjoy it. Enjoy the benefits that this gives you. In terms of home working, you have less commuting, hopefully less stress, being able to go for a walk at lunchtime, and that you can now manage your own time. So I would say these 10 tips generally applies to yourself as a leader, but you can certainly also use these tips with your team as you engage with them around how to make the best out of the situation today under those this scenario you have today. Excellent. So let me move on to talk a little bit about motivating your remote team as a leaders. And this is certainly one of your prime leadership roles. And one of the challenges is, of course, really about now you are working from home as well, but you may have a large part of your team suddenly forced into this situation. And for that purpose, I'm going to share a little bit of insight from neuroscience. Which I think can help or hope will help to put my tips into context. There's actually some science behind some of the recommendations here and tips. First one is really about the threat detector. So imagine that you're moving through the wilderness eons ago, and as you're moving through that environment, you will be constantly scanning the environment. Your focus will be on detecting any threats to your life from predators, dangerous animals, or other than Neanderthals or human Homo sapiens who surround you, who may want to kill you, or there's a threat of them eating you and so forth. And this element of our brain is deep inside our limbic systems, and it'll react very quickly to any perceived threats. Actually, before any rational thoughts, it's instinctive, and it's designed to protect us and react super quickly. We all know that sense of that anxiety jumping up when we alert. And neuroscience shows us that this system is actually still operating today in the modern human environment. And it affects actually how we interact with people and colleagues. This primitive reaction explains that sometimes we will have strong emotional reaction in social situations which are not life-threatening. And we still can't control it. It happens so automatically, it's instinctive, and we can't just turn it off. So that threat detector is important to recognize. And there's a fellow called David Rock who's done a lot of research around what motivates people. And he looked at the sort of basically measured the brain and looked at social interaction has boiled it down to five areas. And the first element, not the first five, but in terms of from one element of the brain, we sort of try to move away from threat if there's something threatening us. And it's also looking for rewards. And the reason that the left one, the away from threat, is much bigger than the green one towards reward is that, of course, the threat element is so important. This is life and death. So that will, four times more neurons will basically be fired off if there's a threat around us. So one of the key things for us is to recognize that we want to ensure that we don't sort of push those threat buttons. And then the other element is the reward. So that's what we can get out of it, food, partners, and so forth. That's also an important part of what motivates us, but actually the threat element is the dominant one. And the SCARF model basically looks at the five areas, the first one being status. So this is our relative importance to others around us. So one of the things that can happen here is that if we're left out of an activity, if you don't feel we're important or recognize as important, then suddenly we feel our status within the tribe, within our community is threatened. And this actually, the research shows that it can come across almost like a physical pain to us. So this is really important when we recognize, for example, if you furlough staff, if you put staff sort of that they have no work to do, then they suddenly will start to feel threatened in terms of status. What am I here for? What am I needed for? Where can I influence things that might have dropped? So it can be seen as a lot less rewarding work maybe you give to some of your team members, maybe less prestigious, maybe less of a leadership role. That can be a potential threat and have quite a strong response in people. As leaders yourself, the lack of symbols of leadership that you might be used to and accustomed to, the corner office, sitting at the end of a table rather than just on a webinar or a meeting on a screen, that can make you feel that you're not quite the status in before. So that's one element. Second element is certainty. We like to be able to predict the future as human beings. And of course, in the current environment, we don't have much history to base on prediction on how is the world going to look like in some months. We hope it's going to go back to normal, but some people will worry a lot about that and a lot of anxiety in your team. And that's probably less about homeworking than anything else, although I will come up with some tips around that. Third element, autonomy. What's really important to human beings is that we have a sense of control over the events around us. And when we lose that sense of control, we really feel that that's a losing influence, is a real threat to us. And that could be an issue for managers yourself. Maybe that sense of losing control where you might have an approach previously, a fairly close oversight of your team members, being able to see them, whether they turn up at 9 o'clock in the morning, maybe a little bit of micromanaging, what are they getting involved in? And some people naturally focus a lot on what they can control while others more on what they cannot control. So that loss of autonomy, for example, restrictions on our social interactions now can really affect people. And then there's the fourth one, relatedness. This is a sense of safety with others, whether they're friend or foe to us. And as you work to make sort of a transition that people are now suddenly working from home, it's important to keep in mind how deeply ingrained it is in human behaviors, this relatedness to others is. In the early days, as I talked about, you're running in the wilderness. If you weren't part of a tribe, you risk being eaten by a predator. Being part of a tribe, of a group, is part of what protects us. It's a core part of what we are as human beings. So we're intentional social beings, and we want to feel connected. And personal sharing is actually one of the easiest and most overlooked ways of creating that connection, especially when your staff team is remote. And then the last one is fairness. This is that perception as a fair exchange between people. And that's a particular area of concern when staff and leaders need to deal with remote working. People need to feel they're fairly treated, and it's very easy if you don't have, it's almost like close day-to-day connection, to start to read things into emails, start to feel missed out. Maybe you forget to thank remote team members enough, a bit out of sight, out of mind, you focus on other things. And for example, an example I tried myself many years back where I made the mistake of, if you call one of your team members that's been a remote, and as you call them at 10 o'clock, you're normally at work, you expect the team to be at work, but the remote team member doesn't answer the phone. They might be out taking care of a child. They have made an appointment. And you start to question the reason they weren't at the desk. Well, that is starting to show that you don't trust them. It feels unfair. They might still be putting all the hours and effort in, but it just wasn't in that 9 to 5 schedule. So being really clear on and being fair, recognizing people and how you value them is really important. So those are the 5 to keep in mind. And it's a really good sort of scarf to remember that when you're dealing with remote team members, and to be fair, also with anybody who's co-located with you when they start to come back. These are important social motivations for your team members and yourself, of course. So what are the tips? Well, I have 5 that really relates to this, the 5 I just mentioned. So make people feel important and included. It's very important in terms of status. It's easy to feel neglected, excluded, less important than others when you're remote, particularly if a part of the team is still co-located in an office and then you have a few scattered around. So supercharge your communication. And by that, I say that with some caution, because I also notice some people saying over-communication. You do have to choose the right channels. So you have to connect regularly, but recognize that people who are working remotely needs the same level of sense of information. So use the channels correctly. If it's a complex personal issue, a video format is probably the best in person if you can. If it's just a task you want them to do at some point and it's not urgent, immediate, an email is probably better. So choose the channels well. Then build predictable routines. Encourage your team members to have predictable routines in their day. And then build in a regular routines and how you interact with people. Be predictable as well when you're available. And of course, that's the whole aspect about dealing with uncertainty in these times here, but that's a general issue. It's not so much whether it's remote or not. I think it's just heightened the issue that you don't have the sort of, you can put an arm around their shoulders in in-person contact. Then there's the autonomy element. So that's really actually key here, because you cannot micromanage in the way you used to. You need to empower them, give them freedom to manage their own work, feel in control of their workday, and actually show that you trust them. So this is where a coaching approach is a much better way than a task management oriented approach to drive performance. And I'll talk a little bit about that when I talk about productivity later. Then relatedness. Make sure there's a regular social interaction, even if it is virtual. The recognize we're social being, build a team spirit, humor, banter. Don't make every meeting too task orientated. Some task orientation, some drive to deliver and performance, absolutely. But recognize that in a normal setting, you would probably come into a meeting room and just say, how are you today? Oh, you look a bit tired. How was your day yesterday? How's the family? You would do that in a normal in-person co-located team. Remember to do that when you're doing it online as well. And then on the fairness side, remember to recognize and value your team member. Remember to say thank you. Remember that that they will probably have that less interaction of you saying thank you as you walk past. So build in good opportunities to do that. Use coaching to understand what's going on with them. Then a couple more. Continue to grow and develop your remote team members' capabilities. Remember, they need a career path and opportunities as well. And millennials and Generation Z that's come into your team, they want this, they expect it. So whether they're working in an office or working remotely, make sure that you really think through, how do I keep developing the skills? How do I keep growing them, making them more capable, better social interaction, and better technically? And then a key last point, also related up to relatedness, monitor the mood closely. And this again, where a coaching approach rather than a task management directive approach just works better. Have conversation about how they're feeling, check in with them, see where they're struggling, help them overcome those things themselves so they become more resourceful. And a simple tip as well that I know works really well when we're helping other leaders and teams figure out how to work effectively in remote teams. Get other team members, get colleagues to look out for each other. So when they have conversation, that they spot things. So we know that it is a team that is looking out for each other. Excellent. So Gunnar, can I?
Yeah, again? Can you hear me? Yeah.
Let me just stop sharing and then see if there's any questions.
There actually is. There's been a couple of good questions here already. One that may actually be more of a comment. I don't know if you can answer it. Let's try. Guy Brumby, he says, how likely is an international failure of the internet and what is being done or not to protect its integrity?
I would have to admit that there my technical expertise is nil. I use the internet as much as I can. I try to understand it. And I'm an engineer background, so it's probably a bit of a failure of my background that I cannot answer that. So actually, I can't answer that question. I'm sorry.
Maybe if there's someone on the listening here who could put it in on the chat so we can monitor that later.
Yeah.
And then we have a question from this Kentage. I wonder if there's a difference between introverts and extroverts and the choices of working at the office from home.
Yes, there probably is. I think an introvert is maybe more likely to feel quite comfortably working on their own, where some extroverts, the way they get the energy is with social interaction with others. That does not mean you cannot have that interaction, but we just have to do it socially. So we have to engineer it into the team. So if you have team members you know are quite extrovert, make sure they get opportunities to sort of bounce off others. And I, there's specific areas where I know this works really well. So one of the, we know certain things are easy to do in a virtual remote team works where if people are not really interdependent, they can work quite individually on their tasks, that suits remote working. They don't need to have much interaction with others. But in creative environments, in sort of where there's development environments, you have a sense that you need to have people in a room. Actually, we have found experience-wise, you can actually do incredible creative exercises and development using the technology tools. I do believe you benefit a lot from using the video side of it. But here you just have to use the capability of the tools. Zoom has so many things it can do. Chat functions it has. So you can share screens, you can share whiteboards. So you can actually still do a lot of creative work on the hoof type of thing. And then I will just also add, we have many other ways of communicating. WhatsApp, instant messaging, set up WhatsApp for your team. Generally, our experience now is we start to learn this math a lot. So these small social group, WhatsApp or whatever other that you choose to use, don't make them for hundreds. That just gets overwhelming for the remote worker. But if you have a team of, say, 10 people that tend to work closely together, maybe on a project, get them to have a WhatsApp group that they can have this sort of informal communication banter alongside the more formal emails and meetings that they have.
Very good. And if there are other questions, please fire them off. There was one from Daughter here as well asking if it's going to be available from as a recording. And I can confirm, yes, this is being recorded right now. And we will share it with all the participants. And you shall feel free to share it with your colleagues and your organizations as well. So with that, shall we move on till next part?
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Let me do that. So I just make sure I do the right sharing here. So, yeah, let me move on to the right screen here. Just shows the technology side of it. So let's move on to leading a remote team. So yes, we want a bit of interaction. Again, it was great to have all those questions. So I have another question for you. As leaders that has now people out working remotely, what have you found to be the most challenging aspect of leading these remote teams? So if you will push that into the webinar chat and remember to make it to all panelists and attendees so everybody can see all the comments coming in. What have you found to be the most challenging aspect of leading a remote team? providing emotional support, yeah, good ones, ongoing communication, the right level of contact, yeah. Having enough time, yeah, I can appreciate that. Keep going, yes. Everybody online at the same time? Oh, that's an interesting one. Yeah, different communication methods for different team members, absolutely, yeah. Supervision, good one, yeah. The drop off for social interaction, informal, yes, absolutely. That's one of the challenges, the social side, yeah, good, very good. Yeah, so there's fundamentally here, there's a one element I think is really important is to manage what you don't notice and know what's actually going on. So, and then you have the different personalities, which I think Liz was had mentioned that, yeah, so one thing you do need to is to have to really recognize that people will want to do it differently. That's the same as you in the office, but it's you can get a bit more heightened, but also sometimes maybe more opportunities that if you know some people like a lot of communication, a lot of detail, we'll try and give them that so they can work at their best when they're remote, while others you know, don't want all the details. They easily get overwhelmed with information. Well, you focus your attention on how you communicate differently. So it's more about being acutely aware of the preferences because they don't have the same opportunity to then sort of easily just look over the desk and ask somebody else. That will feel a bit more sometimes inconvenient if that to WhatsApp it or send an email. Naturally socialize. Hard to learn if people are motivated. Yes, that's a good one, Helena. So yeah, I will come to, so the hard to know it, that's really about this. Keep an eye on their mood. And keep an eye also on how much work are they actually producing. But it is noticing in your meetings in various states. So absolutely. So a lot of good points coming up there. Leadership style as well, I think, is an important one to recognize how you do that here. Because that micromanagement directive style, you actually have to put on the back burner here. This is a bit about much more about interaction with most team members. You can argue that'll be better possibly in the office environment as well, but it just comes more to the fore and gets a bit more distinct if you don't get it right to get people to work because they want to work, because they're motivated to do so, not because you tell them certain things need to be done in a certain way. And the informal part, one thing that I think I haven't quite seen or saw in the word informal mentioned a few times. What quite a lot of organizations, the informal networks are actually what makes things work in reality. it is not all the formal ones. It's that conversation between two people who like each other that sometimes overcomes problems. So the importance of building team spirit becomes really important. So let me share what I think sort of as four C's, as I call it, that I believe really sort of sets the difference between whether your team will be thriving or failing. And I think that will answer a lot of those questions here, I hope. Otherwise, keep posting them up again as a question later. So the first one is communication. And when we do exercises sometimes in this space here, we do a simple exercise to illustrate the pitfalls. We divide a team into groups of four. And then we ask the first person, we give them a picture, and then we ask them to describe it to another of those four team members over video. And then we ask, without naming it outright, I should say, then that person that has now received it over the video communicates to the third person by phone, without again mentioning it, but describing it, then the third person mentioned or goes to the fourth one via an email instructing them how to recreate the image. And so that basically is communicated now to four different people with three different means here. And as you can imagine, this produces a lot of laughs and a lot of strange drawings. So we have to recognize that the different communication channels have very different impact in terms of describing complexity. So one thing that is important, you do need to supercharge your communication. And that's two ways, both in terms of how much you listen to your team member and your transmission. And it's part of the way you engage with the team. So match the message with the medium. I think I mentioned that before. If it's complex, use video. If it's a non-urgent small request, email is probably better. Use WhatsApp for the social interactions and encourage your team to interact one-to-one so it doesn't come all the way up through you, like you're the only central point. That can really go wrong in terms of the cultural element that I come to. Make sure you encourage one-to-ones between the team members. If you have a large team, maybe subgroups to fix problems like you would normally do in an office environment. And then be available and timely in your communication and show that you value each of them. And one last element around communication, you of course also have to encourage the team to work out with the team. If there's other parts of the organization, customers, suppliers they need to communicate with, they must not sort of lower their standards and how they communicate there. And if you are in that situation, and this goes a little bit beyond the COVID sort of restrictions we have today, if you get into situations where you have a like semi virtual team where some are co-located with you in an office and others are remote, make sure you have a level playing field that everybody are well equipped and have the information and encouragement from you. And then generally, as a, almost like a headline is, let go of the belief that virtual is never as good as in person. It can actually be phenomenally good. The workshop we ran last week, it was actually feedback from one of the participants was that the virtual format we used for the training was better than in person. So it's amazing what you can do. We just need to believe that it can be done and go with it. Get the best out of the technology. Second element, second C, coordination. Sort of coordinating remote workers is like choreographing a troop of blindfolded synchronized swimmers, and is particularly challenging these creative, highly interdependent teams, but it's not impossible, definitely not. And this is about recreating the informal ways we touch base. I think that's the act, that's the main key. And that can be through the chat forums. And then there's the collaboration tools, project management tools, and makes a huge difference that when you have worked with the team around developing the plans and the team might have developed themselves, make really sure what is each doing, each individual doing as they're sitting as an individual back in their home or their individual workplace. What are each person doing? And then you have to build a culture, which is the next second. Third one. It's really about a culture that in order for us to work efficiently, we must have these updated timely so the team can trust that the information is there, that it's accurate and up to date. And part of doing this well, the coordinating well and building that culture is that you start to build that sense that we have a shared purpose, a shared goal. We know where we're all going, we're aligned. And since remote workers rarely meet the team members, one of the challenges can be that it's not only you as a leader that gets a little bit too task focused at times maybe, but actually they do as well. And they work on the task, but forget a little bit about interacting with others. And that may work for a while, but if you don't have a culture of engagement, it will not be sustainable. Remember, it's almost thinking in your head is, when they're co-located, what sort of conversations happens? How can I make sure they still happen? You need to create that virtual water cooler tea kettle space for building trust relationships. And then the last C, coaching. Micromanagement doesn't work in remote team. It doesn't. A few scenarios, call centers that we work with where they start to actually allow the teams to work remotely, really, really effectively, productively. They work better when they work from home as long as the technology is working for them. And they can measure really clearly on how often, are they, when are they picking up the phone, how long are the phone, what's the rates of engagement they have with clients, feedback and so forth. But for many other industries, that's not possible. So it's really important to help them perform at their best that you start to use a coaching approach to help them be at the best, be good at making decisions at home themselves, working autonomously. Because you don't want to be a bottleneck that have to constantly check in with. That may work when you sit in an office and you might sit even at a desk next to them. But it doesn't work if you now have that distance of literally you're not physically together. So you need to make sure that they collaborate and they communicate well. But, and once you have that in place, by the way, what is your key role as a leader? Get out of the way. Then you have a team that can start to deliver on its own. You know that they're working, you know where they are, you know it's coordinate, and your key role is communicating what's the purpose, the goals, what are we trying to achieve, and make them collaborate. That's the four C's. That brings me on to the last subject of today. That's about productivity. And that's a really quick poll. It's actually just one question I would like to answer here. And this is just to understand whether you found productivity to go up or down and to what extent. So very quickly, if you can answer this question. Oh, you're quick this time. You're getting used to this. As before, I'll give it we'll probably give it 30 seconds. Oh, you're coming really, really quickly here. You're at 60% already. And I know by that time I can pretty much end the polling. Yes. Polling ended. And I'll share the results. Hopefully the share. Yes. See, this is interesting. And probably what we actually see quite often, because research shows that productivity can actually increase and usually increase in remote working. But the challenge I think we had, the reason it has not improved more, is that this was not really well planned. The offices weren't set up, leaders weren't ready for this. The communication systems, the decision-making processes weren't set up to work effectively. Certainly not with everybody leaving the office almost overnight. So what I'm seeing here, that's declining a little for 24% and declining a lot for 15%. That declining a lot, of course, that's really a leadership challenge for you. How can I get the most out of the team? And it is really one of the things that I just want to discuss here. How can you keep that productivity up? And sometimes you probably have to realize that it's not possible. The work isn't there that was there before. So did I take that off? I did indeed. And so go to the next. Oh, I just see it's a different button I need to click. So one of the key things here is trust. You need to trust the team members and you need to build that trust. And the key to all of this is really a mindset shift, I would say. So instead of relying on observing your staff and looking at how many hours are they in the office? Do they turn up at 9? How long are their breaks? Do they take too many smoking breaks or coffee breaks? That really might have worked back in an industrial setting, but with knowledge workers in particular, it isn't really that useful when you want the best of their brains, their creativity. So you now have to find other methods. So when you cannot see what they're doing, what is the alternative here? Well, that's really to focus on what they achieve rather than the effort. So the output rather than the input. So this is the results, the deliverables is what you need to start to put the focus on, not the time, the activities, the tasks they're doing. And the first element for that, there's four to this, the goal setting. And it's one of the things that I see too often, that the goal setting by the leaders for what is actually that the end goal is here for what I want you to do. Maybe some just the tasks end goal. That needs to be really clear to align staff's efforts, particularly if it's more than one involved in it. Be really clear on what matters and what adds value and what doesn't. That doesn't mean you cannot be ambitious and visionary and create sort of the right amount of pace and urgency, but you need to be clear. And you need to be clear on who's accountable and responsible for what. Sometimes it's not you that's leaders that need to define that in detail, that you can allow the team to figure that out. But the team also then needs to be really clear who is doing what tasks, when are we expecting it from each other, they hold each other accountable. And then you help them prioritize their time. Second element you need to focus on, capability. And I believe actually that's pretty much your top job as a leader. Once you set the goal, you need to build the capability in the team to deliver it. So you need to put the right team together with the capacity, complementary skill set, different personalities maybe, and then tear down any silos to stop them from collaborating. And of course, that also needs to have the technology in place, information available to them so that it works. And then your role in terms of capability is the coaching to develop their skills, maybe a training as well, dealing with barriers that get in the way, help them manage distractions in their remote workspace as well as in the co-located space. The third one Once you've done that, you clear goals, you build the capability, then you empower them to get on with stuff. They decide on the path and they hold each other accountable. And then you trust individuals and you trust the team. That, of course, comes with a little one. It's not just all our blind faith and trust. You do need to monitor then what's happening. But that's on the output. Are they delivering the results? You can use leading indicators, absolutely. Sales environments are the typical one. The end result, the deliverable, is actual sales, pound notes, or whatever currency you're in, euros. But the leading indicators is, are they having the quality of calls, the number of calls you would expect? Can be leading indicators for that they're moving towards the right and to the right end goal. And then tracking their progress. Use team meetings to see everything is going well. Use one-to-ones that you have with them. Monitor the pace and how they're performing. That's basically the four areas. When you look at those, I'm sure you'll say, well, that's no different from when the team is in the office and co-located. No, it isn't. But you have to start to do it and act a lot more rigorously, a lot more on the button to make this actually work. And that basically gets me to the end. So back over to you, Gunnar. Can you come in or do I need to unmute you? Nope, you are straight in. It's all working.
Yes. Thank you very much, Jan. There's some questions, and there's still time to shoot off some questions if you have anyone in the audience. So one was from Ian. That's probably more common to one of your questions early on. It's the challenge of making sure staff feel supported and getting staff up to speed on using all the benefits of technology. Maybe that's a question or more of a comment.
Yeah, I agree with that. Yes, that's undeniable. So sometimes the coaching and the support might be actually to use the technology. We have been quite surprised actually with young people how not good they are with the technology. It might surprise you a lot. but what we found is that actually I'm not talking about really young people, so sort of the late teenagers in the early 20s, they've been used to the smartphone and actually not used to using the a laptop. So it's funny, it seems funny to me now being in my 50s that's the case. But actually some of them had to have training around using some of the base technology, like a laptop, like some of the Microsoft tools on the laptop setting.
Interesting. The next one is from Josh. What is your advice on keeping the team focused? I think this is mainly due to the current situation, but I'm finding keeping our team focused on our strategy and vision while we've been going through a lot of changes and everyone moving out of the office has been a real challenge.
Yes, and absolutely. And I don't want to normalize that element, but it is actually almost like any change situation that you take a team through, which is almost standard in organization, change. This one is just quite dramatic. And it's so dramatic, the change here, that we don't have much to rely on in terms of history and knowledge in our individual heads and even as a society on how to deal with this and what's the consequences. So what's my advice? Well, as in any change situation, which is actually my background way back, is you almost have to look at it as a change curve and really be observant of where along this journey are the individuals. Are they still in the shock state, overwhelmed, a bit angry, resentful? They're the stage now where you can start to work with them. This, in the first stage, you're really just about listening, understanding where they're coming from. And then as you go through the stages, you start to help them build the confidence, being clear on what they need to do, what's important, what matters. And then actually one simple tip that I found work well in this environment is help them stop doing stuff that's not adding value now, because a lot of people go home and continue to do stuff that was sort of felt maybe added value when they're in the office in the world a few weeks back, admired at this point saying, stop it. At this point, wait until we're back in the office before we start to look at some of those things. It doesn't matter very much. Focus on this instead. So you need to be very clear in your head on what matters and what adds value.
Good. Now the questions are pouring in and I'm slightly aware of that we are overrunning time. Let's there's a couple of really good ones here. One is from Juha Mati, is there a difference between leading your employees compared to managing remotely upwards, for instance, with your company board?
Ah, excellent question. It's almost like I need to think about this one because I sit on two boards as well. So I'm just thinking of, and interesting enough, we have one of the SM team members from one of them on the call. So I have to be careful what I say now. I think actually in some respects, no, because often in a board, for example, and I mean board as in a board that meets four to six times a year to support the team, they're actually typically in that role more used to, as a board member, to not be involved in the day-to-day stuff. So if it's that level of non-executive director element, I think that's not where you need to worry about. You need to keep them informed, of course. They have to make decisions. There's a lot of uncertainty and big decisions they need to make. So my experience at the minute is we're having a lot more conversations with the SMT as a board. We're meeting more often just to deal with this emergency situation. But actually, that's what a board should be used to or ready for, to deal with when an organization their directors for suddenly face a situation where they need to put their collective heads together to support them.
Okay, then maybe a couple of quick questions. I'm going to answer the read them out loud first, and then you answer them three and as quick as you can.
Okay, good.
the first one is here. How do you create your virtual cooler coffee environment? Can you give some examples?
Yes.
And the other one was, what is your recommendation to address conflicts, virtual conflicts? How do you discover the conflict that you unrarely will have in your company as well between employees or cases or projects?
Oh, yes.
And the last one, maybe we should take for now, just because we are aware of time here, where workflow falls due to current environment, how do you keep staff engaged and motivated?
Yes. So I'll start. You might have to remind me, Gunnar, so I'm not careful.
I'll do.
A couple of tips. Let me start with that one. In terms of creating the informal space, we tried some things around the place and can see them working. So a simple one, when you arrange a team meeting, use virtual. Make sure everybody actually comes on with a picture. So they might have to set up their home environment so it works. And then literally do like you would normally do in a meeting. Start with a check-in. How is everybody doing? Go around the room. What's happening for you? How are you feeling? What's going on? So that's one. So encourage that type of dialogue before you get into the meet or whatever meeting subject you have. WhatsApp, instant messaging for small groups. Don't make it for 200 people together. That just means hundreds of messages coming in. No, that wouldn't happen in an organization either, would it? You wouldn't meet with 100 people every day, most likely. You will meet with the 10 around your near team, near the coffee machine. Set up a small WhatsApp group for them that they can communicate with. That works really well. And allow that to be the banter, the fun at times, because that actually gives you got a sense of mood in the team as well. So some of those tricks, just almost think, when do people have informal chats? Encourage that to happen. But almost take it outside of the email, for example, space, because that then becomes more the formal work engaged work. What was the second one?
And then there was the challenge of identifying and address negativity, conflicts. How do you recommend how to address those conflicts?
Well, actually, it's almost like in a normal working environment. And when you see large organizations, how do you know it's happening? That's when people tell you, if they trust you, that you will deal with the information well. So one of the things you may ask when you're coaching people, of course, is literally what barriers they have. Where do you see conflict happening around the organization? So you keep a close eye on that. If you have a larger team with several levels of management, encourage managers right through that chain to saying, where do we see things not working? And make sure you deal with it appropriately. And the last one,
I think you pretty much answered in some of the slides. And let me remind, we're going to share the presentation and the recordings post-event with you all. Where workflow falls due to the current environment, how do you keep staff engaged and motivated?
Well, actually, I would also have to say we might have to accept that we're furloughing some staff is necessary, because just in the current work environment, there isn't necessarily the work for everyone. But I can generally say what I've seen work well in some, in this environment particularly, is start to become innovative. Do some of the things that you would like to have done that still add enough value to justify you paying staff salaries, but get things sorted. So in our organization, we have 15 coaches and trainers. We are very busy actually at the minute developing some online learning materials to try and things we talked about for years, but just didn't take the time. You might have other things you can do in terms of engaging with new people that that you didn't before, because to be honest, I'm finding that some senior people I can easily get hold of now than I could 2 months ago.
Very good. Let's wind this up now. on behalf of the three organizing chambers, the Nordic British Chamber of Commerce, the Finnish British Chamber of Commerce, and the Danish UK Association, we would very much like to thank all the participants, but in particular also Jan for contributing with all his good knowledge and content here. We are all here to continue connecting you. We are still active. We are not sitting in the office. We are working remotely, all of us, but by that, we are still reachable by phones and emails. And as this is an example, please do consider where we can also maybe help you to bring content and matter to the forefront through webinars and other technologies we can consider, whether it's just practically COVID information or more practically what Jan came with today, or indeed business development on new technologies. Keep it in mind, we'd be happy to connect you. The next webinar we have next week on the 15th of April, where we're looking at marketing, how to keep on top of that. But for now, thank you very much, all of you, to Jan, and have a good day, all of you.
Thank you.